The theme of my speech as for keynote address is about Europe between hopes and anxieties. Talking at the beginning of the 21st century about how Europe will face the challenges of this century is undoubtedly an intellectual challenge. The literature on these subjects is abundant, and therefore claiming to bring a truly new perspective may seem much too bold. On the other hand, one might reply, not without reason, the challenges of present are so urgent and important that we should try to answer them before exploring a future still characterized by so many assumptions. Our post-industrial global era imposes an unprecedented dynamic even in the tallest decisions to be made and those encompassing much of the future. Any long-term strategy developed by technicians as well as politicians feeds from a prospection and a reflection on possible developments. But today, the speed of the change is so high that obligation to act quickly often requires simultaneous strategies and tactics, leaving too little space for reflection. It seems, however, that present reveals us a more and more obvious as a memory of the future. In other words, present is not sufficient to itself, not longer, is not capable to run out our wishes and aspirations anymore. More than any other time in history, we cannot consider the present but subordinated to the future. It is just this fact that gives me the courage to speak out today about the challenges that third millennium Europe will face. Some time ago, rereading Faust, I saw this book as an amazing prediction upon the contemporary Western world. In a time when the dawn of the Industrial Revolution were scarcely rising, Goethe foreseen the issues the West faces today. In the spirit of the new rising time, he was looking for an introductory idea and finds in the Old Testament, in beginning was the word. He gives up and chooses in the beginning was the idea. He gives up on and that to and decides for in the beginning was the deed. In the end of the second part of his work, freed from the story of poor Margaret, we discover an amazing parable of the modern West. Faust is getting ready to building a great city and a channel to link it to the sea in order to turn a marshy area into a vivid land. An old man's house, prevents him from doing what he intended to, so she sent Mephisto to persuade the old man to move away and not to stay in the way of his prodigious urban project. Mephisto takes advantage of these circumstances and kills the old man. Hearing about these murders upsets Faust, but not too much, as he was accepting that collateral sacrifices must be made in order to accomplish a great achievement. Absorbed by his great project, Faust seems not to seize that four shadows were heading towards him. They were shortcomings, needs, debts, and worries. While approaching Faust's house, shortcomings, needs, debts, stop, saying, "We cannot get inside a wealthy man's house." On the contrary, worry says, "I can get in everywhere, and sneaking in the house through the keyhole," she asks Faust if he has worries. Faust, in an arrogant manner of a knowledge-absorbed person, answers, "I never had worries." Then, worry wants to blind him, as only the blind do not worry about what might happen. The book ends with a blind Faust fastening even more now to achieve his work. He is happy to hear the noise of pickaxes, only that workers were not digging the channel, but his own grave. He tells Mephisto he's happy, although he knows that according to their contract, in this case, his soul will go to the devil. Despite all bad deeds Faust had done, despite the murders committed in the league with the devil, God eventually forgives him in the last minute after having been watching his deed. Goethe tells us that the one who deserves his freedom and his life is the one who wins them every day. Since Faust achieved a spectacular deed in the end, his soul is prevented from getting to devil. His salvation comes from the intervention of two Marys, Maria Magdalena and Mary of Egypt, former sinners, Turner now religious, who had taken his soul to lead it to the purgatory. Margaret is also getting involved, begging Virgin Mary to save Faust. It is a good thing to build. It is a good to use your creative energies, as Goethe suggests. But you must never forget that in the end, only love can save your soul. I believe that Europe needs, besides the acquis communautaire and the economic, administrative, social, and military project, to rediscover the European ethos. That Weltanschauung, through which German philosopher considered that every age had its own way to see and understand the world, is still productive today, especially if we see it as a gestalt, this Weltanschauung, where the whole represents more than the sum of the parts forming it. This concept corresponds best to what should be the European Union in the world of tomorrow, a complex model of solidarity and cooperation, showing respect to cultural, religious, ethnical identities of all the nation it is comprised of. If we talk about new European Union member states, we might ask ourselves, what is the added value new European Union members bring, and what is the added value they received from the European Union? If we were to use the contemporary debate dedicated terminology, we could ask ourselves how the country brand changes for each member of state, and which could be the Europe's brand in a globalized world. But we risk stepping into the advertising and public relations fields, which invaded the electoral campaign, degenerated not once into cheap populism. On the opposite side, we risk to enter in a conform language of the European bureaucracy, a technical and politically correct language, making up unpleasant realities, but without solving real problems. None of these approaches can help us manage the serious challenges of tomorrow's world, with societies traumatized by the obsession of risk European integration and the globalization involved. A traumatized society is the one whose leaders are not able to explain either the historical project mission or the balance between gains and costs. Still, citizens' capacity to support important projects must not be underestimated. We should never forget that the European Union is the most important historical project of the 20th century, and it is unique through its complexity in the world history. We can find in the present European Union the same people that a century and a half ago fought to free themselves from the Habsburg, Ottoman, and Tsarist empires in order to build a national state able to modernize themselves and join to Western Europe prosperous states. The European Union succeeded to stop the old intra-European conflicts that had generated two world wars, and after the fall of communism, to generate a strong attraction towards Europe of the state in the former Soviet Union area of influence. That countries which have otherwise become victims of regional and domestic conflicts frozen under communist dictatorship. People from Central and Southeastern Europe have proved an unthinkably understanding, a sacrifice capacity, and a solidarity to be envied. But Europe, towards which their energy have focused with such force, cannot be reduced to the sum of states and nations which compose it, neither can be considered a larger nation. Europe is a vast ongoing experience, the experience of solidary differences and of equality in diversity. That is why I believe that the long way towards a complete European solidarity must begin from within each nation, local community, or even family, where when we can often find contradiction we describe as being typical to discrepancies between North and South or West and East on a global perspective. But in those very places we can also identify the identity bond of a common ethos. We speak about European identity founded on shared values. What are these values that define the European identity? How could we surpass it but not forgotten the specific characteristics and even the national limits on the way towards a common identity? The answer of these questions lies in the very heart of the European project, but also in the causes of European anxieties. If we continue to propose projects without taking into account the inevitable anxieties involved by political construction with 500 million inhabitants, then we have poor chances to develop a powerful and democratic Europe. My generation is used to talk about European values by referring to democracy, freedom, equality of citizens, often using this word without thinking about their deep meaning. What does it mean in the age of global communication to make a participatory democracy out of the European Union? To support an act of frequent public consultation, to include the electronic referendum in the institutional mechanism, to conceive an administration not only at local or national level, but on European level too, which might reorganize as a governing entity according itself to the new ways of communication. Certainly, modern world should finance its technical development, as it would allow us to live and progress throughout our lives. But last century Europe occasionally arises from time to time, even in stronger democracies. Not everywhere distrust in the other will to completely forgotten. Since the Cold War until today, diverse kinds of extremism have built their political profile, stranding for recent residues that periodically recur as if to remind us that democracy is at stake in a never concluded fight. Such residues are particularly striking in societies in transition, which should leave behind what seemed to the fatality of communist dictatorship and to travel by burning stages, the modern roads, to reach the level of society that we'll ally with. At the same time, we must learn what social fractures, dialogue with minorities and neighbors mean. We must realize the isomorphism with values, rules, and practices of European Union member states to find together the optimum balance between our particular identities and our European identity. We also have to rethink our own past without hate and without indulgence, while accepting at the same time hardly tolerable effects of an economic, social, cultural reconstruction capable to disturb our lives. While member countries sacrifice several material resources and human energies to make the integration process work, societies aspiring to integration must climb an abrupt slope full of obstacles. Any traumatized human being tends to isolate in the past as in a refuge. For this, should it be condemned or encouraged? The failure of totalitarianism was due to the desire of liberty existing in the human nature, An irreversible desire once decided to be achieved in the conscience of long-time oppressed peoples could not be stopped from becoming a force able to build a new political and social organization based on respecting everyone's right to dignity and identity. Rediscovering the profound values of ancient civilizations and, on the other hand, promoting the individual autonomy are essential issues that must be the foundation of our common bridge to the future. A rearticulation of Europe to its cultural traditions will prove that the past can be valorized in its true position and that there is no antagonistic relation between tradition and modernity. The third millennium civilizations will not be a civilization of economic rationality as is it developed in the West during the last centuries. It will be more a knowledge civilization, a civilization of synthesis. In Central and Eastern Europe, this truth is almost tautological, as here civilization defines itself less than civilization of efficiency, calculation, and utility, and rather than civilization reflection, imagination, and creativity. That is why I believe that this type of civilization that modernity did not encourage is almost paradoxically quite well prepared to face the future. This equal willingness to metaphysics and socializing is probably the most valuable heritage that this part of Europe can provide to the whole Europe. In addition, as I said, this part of the continent is able to transmit also its indivisible and fundamentally common experience, an experience of resistance and solidarity, an experience of change and victory over fear in which it lived from half a century. The pedestal of the third millennium Europe will lie on, will not to be, not be the one of smoldering confrontation. We will not live anymore in a vulnerable area, divided between friends and enemies. This forces us to rethink politics and review the significance of political action. If, for some time, politics is no longer interpreted as a way of organizing the relations between friends and enemies, from now on, it should be seen as the only possible way to be together, as a bundle of practices and initiatives that are not intended to separate, but on the contrary, to gather all the major components of the society around a common project. We did not reach an end of history. History continues and measures the degree of our readiness to face the challenges of a new millennium. Since the end of the Middle Ages to the 21st century, the outburst of nationalisms was often a result of poverty, while today in the rich European countries, ultranationalism acts as a refusal to share the wealth accumulated with the people in need, thus preventing ultranationalism outbreaks depends largely on the removal of certain historical barriers. The first barrier is related to the elite and the masses. In the antiquity and in the Middle Ages, the elite set cultural, economic, and social ways for vigorously marking the society cleavages. Enlightenment and the Industrial Revolution were marked by the slow lifting of people through its progressive participation in the symbolic and material values of the elite. 20th century overturned this process. The elite is the one participating until dissolution in the mass culture. Undoubtedly, laminating economic and social differences is a positive effect of our times, but it should not be pursued at the cost of flattening the hierarchy of values. More and more equal, yet different in cultural, personal, and collective identities. The second psychological barrier separates the North, prone towards working, rationality, individualism, and the South, leaning towards contemplation, affection, and community solidarity. Finally, the third barrier is between West and East. The history of the European world is a history of great cyclical transfer of civilization in a first step from the East to the West, then since the beginning of the modern age, from the West to East. The Western industrial civilization, which prevails for over a century as a model of inspiration and influence for the political, social, economic evolution in South, East, and East, today turned into a society organized to produce, consume, communicate. What to produce? What to consume? What to communicate? To produce only what the market demands? To consume only what advertising strategies claim that the market would demand? To communicate only what international press agencies choose and decide this must be transmitted? These are some questions that await answers. We must find ways to face difficulties without making sacrifices, to overcome the past without forgetting it, to expand our linguistic and cultural horizons without ignoring our own language, to get over geopolitical areas from the Atlantic to the Urals without losing our curiosity or our legitimate pride. My generation has enlarged in Europe, founding by predecessors, making the Berlin Wall fall. Now is the time for a new generation to act decisively, amplifying the meaning of European values up to the level of their aspirations. New generation might build a new destiny, not only for their countries and for Europe, but also for the entire world. Thank you for your attention.